The main ideas in our transpositional grammar are form and function. Forms are the things we do to make meaning, and functions are the kinds of meanings we make.
Now, the forms of meaning are the ways in which meaning is made manifest. The list we have here is everything, the only ways meanings reach us as sentient creatures, but more particularly as a very specific species of animal. Of course, all animals make meaning in the sense that they make their way around in the world. Primates, for instance, and I'm sure you know how smart your dogs and cats are. But insects even, think how smart ants and bees are in their elaborate societies. Our list of forms of meaning is just a rough classification of the main ways our species has evolved to make meaning. And this is what we mean by each. Text consists of graphemes. Here's a grapheme. And there are two kinds of graphemes. One kind of grapheme represents phonemes or speech sounds. But another kind of grapheme is an ideograph, which represents an idea. Today, there's just one universal catalogue of graphemes, and this is something that's called Unicode, and we'll be speaking about this later. And this includes 100,000 plus characters in every human language, but also it includes thousands of emojis. These are examples of ideographs. Now, image, the next of our forms of meaning, is a two-dimensional array represented on a surface. It might be something imaginary, or it might be something real. Space is a three-dimensional array represented like this, and object is a tangible three-dimensional thing. Body is sensuous feeling, the way I feel at the moment, you know, hot or cold or happy or sad. It's various forms of enactment. Here's Uncle Sam pointing. And he's doing that via something that we call a gesticulation. And also he has a certain appearance, what he's wearing, the hat he's wearing. Sound is audible meaning, alerts, ambient sounds. Music is one very prominent and important part of sound in our cultures. And speech is a system of voiced sound. So these are the systems of meaning that we're going to be talking about. And barely ever does one form of meaning happen without one or more of the others. And always we find ourselves making transpositions from one form of meaning to another during the process of meaning. And if one form is not enough, we supplement it with another in order to add sense to what we're saying.
So if the forms are how meaning happens, then the functions are what meaning does. And we propose five functions: reference, agency, structure, context, and interest. All five of these things are always happening in every meaning, even if for the moment we may have our attention more focused on one function rather than another. This translates into five questions we can ask about any meaning, every meaning, in any form, or in any combination of forms. For example, a reference asks the question, what's this about, across all the meaning forms. Agency asks, who or what is doing this in any particular form? And structure asks, what holds it together? And context asks the question, what else is this meaning connected to? And lastly, interest, the function of interest asks, what's this for? What is the purpose and ideological background? We call this a functional grammar because our focus is on what meaning does, its purposes. With these five functions, we want to develop a shared pattern language able to explain how text, image, space, object, body, sound, and speech work together to convey the same meanings. To give you just one example from the first of these functions, reference, instead of noun and verb, we want to use the term entity and action, because these concepts are able to describe a distinction that can be made across all forms of meaning. And by the way, Michael Halliday, in his functional grammar, focused on the first three of our functions, though he called them metafunctions rather than simply functions as we do. What we now call reference, he called ideational. Our agency, he called interpersonal. And our structure, he called textual. But we have added two more that we call context and interest. Halliday spoke of context also, as did Rukaiya Hassan, at great length. They also spoke of purpose, which we have named interest. But these were things that sat outside of the grammar for Halliday. We add them to the system because we believe they are essential and distinct aspects of meaning as a system. Then, for any meaning, we can analyze what happens when form meets function. This is the way to parse, if you like, the patterns of meaning across all forms of meaning. In these videos and the two volumes and the website that goes with them, we go into great deal of detail, filling out the blank cells of this table, developing contributing concepts, bringing in other scholars who have thought about these things and these and other related ideas, and providing different examples.
In the table you just saw, we've laid things out in what we call supermarket order. So the thing about supermarkets is you can only put things on the shelf in one place. Maybe they could go in a number of different places, but you get to know roughly where things are. So, you know, we often have a sense that you might find the yogurt somewhere near the milk. Less obviously, perhaps, experience in insects tell you that you're more likely to find the dishwashing detergent somewhere nearer the pet food than the milk. So we've roughly put these in a kind of order, but we mean to be them to be in this order. These are things which are the contiguous things across the horizontal axis and the vertical axis, are things which sort of roughly go together and which kind of connect with each other. So here are some of the reasons we put things where we have on our metaphorical supermarket shelf. On the horizontal axis, text is essentially a visual thing. Graphemes laid out on a two-dimensional plane. And two-dimensional planes offer representations of space, or three-dimensional planes. That's what images often do. They take something three-dimensional and they put it into two dimensions. At the other end, we find that speech is materialized in sound, and it's quite closely aligned to bodily configurations. Here am I doing gestures, and the appearance that we have as well, our bodily appearances. And these are often sensuously juxtaposed with objects. We've laid out things in this way because we want to show how different speech is from text. So different, you will see, that we propose to abandon the concept of language. Language is a singularly unhelpful idea for a multimodal grammar because it conflates things which are just so different. Of course, we can write down a spoken word, and this is a multimodal transposition, but it is a transposition that is at least as great as any of the other transpositions across this horizontal array. And if anything, we will argue it's a great it's greater. Then on the vertical axis, the things being referred to are very closely connected to their referrers, the agents of meaning. Structures in meaning, you know, like books, conversations, web pages, useful objects, buildings and such like, make sense by what surrounds them in context. Contexts make sense in terms of interest. And because all the functions are present in any meaning, transposition is a change in our attentions. But we've ordered the attentions here, these five functions, in ways where each of the ideas kind of is roughly connected to the other in the way that we've put them beside each other.